journey that can break us. There are burdens that can bring us to our knees. But it's in these moments when our faith feels weakest that we simply stand our ground and just believe. Pray now, pray now, right here in the storm, he's still the same. Pray now, there is strength and power in Jesus' name, so pray now. Oh, the silence doesn't mean that he's not listening. And the darkness doesn't mean that he is gone. 'Cause he promised he would never ever leave us. And you've never spent one moment on your own. So pray.
Church, got a couple of announcements for you. Want to let you know that the Bible school has been rescheduled tentatively for July 19th through the 24th. Of course, we'll be following whatever guidelines we're given as that date draws closer, but as of now, the Bible school has been rescheduled for July 19th through the 24th. Also, we have a FM transmitter ordered so that we will be able to have some services in the parking lot here where you can remain in your cars and we'll be able to broadcast a service to you. This is going to be coming in the near future here as we try to gradually reopen the church. We miss all of you and hope all of you are well. As we're trying to keep our bodies healthy, as God would have us to, because we know that the body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, we're charged with keeping it healthy and keeping it safe. And that's what we want all of you to do, and what we're trying to do for everyone. But I also want to encourage you to continue to read and study your Sunday school, because our spiritual health is just as important as our physical health. We don't want to neglect that. I'll give you an overview here of the lesson for today. It's in Revelation chapter 3. I want to speak on the last three verses briefly. Revelation 3, verses 20 through 22. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in unto him and will sup with him, and he with me. To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and have sat down with my Father in his throne. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. This is the conclusion to the message and to the other messages to the seven churches as a whole. In verse 20, we find a very sad picture. Jesus standing outside a door. Many use this verse to depict Jesus standing outside the door of the lost person's heart, knocking, seeking to come in and save the person. Now, this is a very powerful image of Christ patiently waiting for us to respond to his calls. We've now experienced something that most of us have never experienced in our lives. We have the doors of the churches closed to us. And unfortunately, all around the entire world, there are churches with the doors closed to Christ. That's what he's saying about the church at Laodicea here. The writer says, keep in mind that Jesus is addressing the church at Laodicea and making them aware of how they have pushed him out of their fellowship by all of their worldly ideas and actions. The members at Laodicea appear to think that they can handle things without the help of Jesus. Everything has been comfortable for them. They've become complacent. They're lukewarm. That's what has happened to many churches around the world, that they have become lukewarm. They've allowed the philosophies and wisdom of the world to come in and take the place of the truth of Christ. We're starting to see that. This is a warning. God's showing us these things. He's given us time to reflect on it. And just as with these churches, he always gives an opportunity. As he has told these churches what they were doing wrong, what they were doing right, he also gave opportunities for them to grow and become greater Christians than they already are. And this is the time that we're living in our lives at this point in time, that we have the opportunity to really examine ourselves and our condition with Christ and to make changes as necessary. That's what the word repent means. It means to make changes. And as we go through these times, we should all look at ourselves and see where we can improve, where we can move closer to the Lord. And thus, possibly, this may be used to bring about a revival around the world. I certainly hope so. I hope that you will continue to read and study your Sunday school lessons. And hope to see you again soon. Thank you.
never said that I would give you silver or gold, or that you would never feel the fire, the shiver in the cold. But I did say you'd never walk through this world alone. And I did say, don't make this world your home. I never said that fear wouldn't find you in the night, or that loneliness was something you'd never have to fight. But I did say I'd be right there by your side. And I did say I'll always help you fight. But you know I made a promise that I intend to keep. My grace will be sufficient in every time of need. My love will be the anchor that you can hold on to. This is the promise. This is the promise I've made to you. I never said that friends would never turn their backs on you, or that the world around you wouldn't see you as a fool. But I did say, like me, you'll surely be despised. And I did say, my way's been found a wise. I didn't say you'd never taste the bitter kiss of death, or have to walk through a chilly Jordan to enter into rest. But I did say I'd be waiting right on the other side. And I did say I'll cry every tear you cry. If you know I made a promise, and now prepare to place, and someday sooner than you think, you'll see me face to face. And you'll sing with the angels, and a compass calls for two. This is the promise. This is the promise I've made to you. Let this be your light. And hell can't separate us, and you're gonna make it through. This is the promise. This is the promise I made to you. Oh, this is the promise. This is the promise I made to you.
Amen. Appreciate all the good singing and everything this morning. Glad to be back and try to say a few words to you, church. We miss you very much, and just hope that soon this will all be over. And my heart's desire is to see the church filled up again. and this all be gone behind us. But I would imagine this is just the beginning of the sorrows. The Bible talks about the end time, and that's what I want to talk to you about this morning a little bit. I'm not a doomsday preacher, but I do believe in the Word of God and what the Word of God says. So I'm going to read you some scripture today, and hopefully it will be a blessing to your heart. I miss all the people, and my heart is very heavy for the church. I was going with my two smallest grandkids yesterday. We went down to see my mother, and the Wesley and Chloe. And Chloe, she looked up at me, and we were driving by the creek, and she said, Papa said, I'm going to be baptized right here. And I said, yeah. And so soon, Chloe got saved a while back at home, and soon we're going to baptize her. But as she looked at me with them beautiful blue eyes, I thought about God's children. And all of us that are saved are God's children. And God loves us with a special love. And if you could think about the love that God loves us with, that he would give his own son, that we could have eternal life. That's a great love. And Christians, I want to tell you today, God, as I've said many times, God has not just dropped us down here in this world to try to, just that we try to make it through. God will be with us, but we've got to ask God to be with us. God give us a place called heaven, but we've got to ask him to save us. I believe, and I truly believe with all my heart, ever since I've been saved, I've studied the scriptures, and I believe with all my heart that this is winding down. And the Bible tells us, and the Bible warns us. And I want to read you some of the things that the Bible talks about in the end days. And I'm not trying to spread fear in people's hearts. And if you do have fear in your heart, the Bible says that the love of God will cast the fear out. And if we get on our knees and we'll pray to God and ask God, if we're not saved, to save us, and ask God to give us that comfort and that peace that only God can give. And I want to tell you something. The peace, and I'm talking about the peace for our souls, it's not found in wealth. It's not found in material things. It's found in God. And if you have fear or doubt, if you'll get on your knees and ask God to meet your needs and to show you what your needs are, and God will show us, and God will show to us if we are lost, and he'll show to us that if we're saved and we have backslid or sin in our life, and if we'll repent, as Clarence read this morning, and I believe that this nation does need to repent. But let me read you this scripture. And think about it today. And my prayer is that the Holy Spirit will speak to all of our hearts and reveal to us the needs that is in our lives. And I want to tell you, God is able to meet your need if you will humble yourselves and seek God's face in your life. The first scripture I want to read to you is found over in Luke chapter 21 and verse 25. And it's talking about the Lord's return. And whether you believe it or not, Jesus is going to come one day and take his church home. And those that are going are those that are saved. And you say, well, how could God do that? Well, God gave his son to come and die for our sins. And to be saved is that we believe that, and we realize that we're a sinner, and we come to God and ask God to forgive us of our sins. And he comes into our heart, saves our soul. And let me tell you, he don't stop there. He writes our name in the Lamb's Book of Life. And God knows his children. It says here, and he's talking about the signs, and I'll read to you in a minute, that no man knoweth the day nor the hour. So I'm not standing here today telling you that today is the day or tomorrow is the day. I'm showing you the signs of his coming. Just like we have been seeing for the last month, the signs of spring coming on us. And spring is here now because we saw the buds come out on the trees, and now the leaves and the warmer weather. So we see all the signs of springtime coming. The Bible gives us the signs of the Lord Jesus Christ coming. And this is some of the signs. It says, "And there shall be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars." So there'll be signs in the heavens that Jesus is coming. And we see that. And upon the earth, distress of nations. We see the nations in distress. Even with this coronavirus, we see distress all over our country, all over the world, distress. And people, I don't want to scare people, and I don't want to put fear in your heart, but let me tell you this. Jesus Christ will take that fear out. But now we need to open up our eyes and realize that this is coming down, and we need to be prepared. And if you have accepted Jesus Christ, there is no reason to have fear in your heart, because God will take care of our children. I'm not saying that there won't be troubles that we're seeing. They'll come. But let me tell you this. I'd rather walk through all the coronaviruses and everything else with the hand of God upon me than to walk through it without the hand of God. And that's what God is offering to this whole world. And I hope, church, I hope you're listening. I hope you're not getting just comfortable by being out of church. I hope you're listening. And listen, men, Diane, we like to see, that the Bynum family's listening, the McCracken family's listening. So just text it in there. We look. So, church, I hope you're listening, because what I'm preaching on here today is, the world getting comfortable. And that's what the world has done. And I'm going to show you in the scripture what the scripture says. So, church, wake up, listen, and let us know you're listening. I'm not sat down. I'm still preaching the word of God. And I want to know that you're listening to the word of God, because we all have to have that spiritual food. Clarence was talking about that. But this is going back to some of the signs. He said, distress of nations with perplexity, and the seas and the waves roaring, men's hearts failing them for fear and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth. You know, a lot of people, there's so much fear today in people's hearts and their lives. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not saying just because you're a Christian, you won't get the coronavirus. I'm not saying that. The Bible says that it rains on the just and the unjust. But I will say this. If you get the coronavirus and you die and you're a Christian, you'll open up your eyes in heaven, in paradise, in a place to where no coronavirus or no other sickness or no other disease. And people, heaven is a wonderful place, and God is offering it to the whole world. And listen, as I said in the beginning, God did not throw us out here in the darkness and say, make it through if you can. He has offered us Jesus Christ. And the Holy Spirit is that light that shines on us and draws us to Jesus Christ. So I encourage you today, listen to the Spirit of God and follow what God says, because this world is going to sleep on God. And we need to wake up. It says, the powers of heaven shall be shaken, and then shall they see the Son of Man coming in the cloud with power and great glory. Jesus is coming,
And he's coming after those that are washed in the blood. What is washed in the blood? Being born again. Accepting Jesus Christ as our Savior. Believing in God. God is telling us to look to him for our strength to get through here. And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. Now, I want to jump on over into verse 34 and read you this. And I feel like that this is where, now this is a warning. God is putting out a warning to the whole world. And I believe this is where the world is. You know, it's just like we're the world is sitting in a hammock and somebody is there just pushing it back and forth and just putting us off to sleep. To where, and he's talking about being asleep on the things of God. And that's where the world is. They're taking the word of God and just pushing it farther and farther and farther out of their lives. Where we need to be feeding upon the word of God. We need to be looking at the word of God. And church, please listen to what God says. And here's God giving us a warning. Take heed to yourself, lest any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeiting. And that means, if you look up the definition of that word, overindulging. Overindulging. That means that I have took the word of God and the ways of God and pushed them out of my life. And now I am overindulging. I am getting drunk, and he's not talking about whiskey here. Of course, I don't believe that a Christian ought to be drinking, but that's not what this scripture is talking about here. It's talking about overindulging and getting drunk into the things of the world. And what does a drunk man do? When a man is drunk, he's not aware of what's going on around him, and that's what the devil does to people in this world. He just keeps luring them into this and into that, and they just keep pushing the ways and the word of God out of their life, and they get overindulged in the things of this world. Whenever we need to take time, and this here with where we're not being able to meet in our church service, that's why I encourage you, put something on there that you're watching and that you're hopefully getting something out of this, and that the Spirit of God, I'm praying, that will stir our hearts and feed our souls, because we need that from God. And it goes on, and it said, and the drunkenness and the cares of this life, and so that day come upon you unaware. See, this day that I'm reading to you about, it's going to come up on a lot of people unaware. They're not going to be looking for it. Now, a lot of people are talking about making gardens because some feel that things might be harder to get. If you wait till August to start your garden, you're not going to get much out of it. All right. What if you wait till the last day or two of your Christian life? You know, what God is saying, don't get wrapped up in the things of the world. Look back at the Word of God. The world is wanting to push this out. They think it's old-timey. They think it's old-fashioned. That it ought to be revised and we ought to get into the new way. Well, let me tell you this. God said that he didn't change. And he is the same yesterday and today. And he is the same God that brought the flood upon this world and destroyed everybody there when he destroyed them. And why did he do that? Because of sin and evil. And man had got himself wrapped up in the world. And the Bible said all he ever thought about was evil continually. Now, and then he goes on and he says this, for as a snare shall it come on them that dwell on the face of the whole earth. Now, if something gets caught in a snare, A snare is a noose that trappers set to catch something. And that, whatever they're trying to catch, don't know that snare is there, and they're in it and caught before they ever know it. And that's what the Bible says. For as a snare shall it come on all them that dwell on the face of the whole earth. And then he says, now this is Jesus speaking to us. He said, watch ye therefore and pray. So God is telling me and you to watch and to pray. Now let me read you just a little more scripture on what he's told us and warning us of the end time and some things. And I pray that we'll just allow the Holy Spirit to open up our eyes, our spiritual eyes, to where we can see the times that we're living in. People, I believe that the scripture is showing us the signs that are out there. I told Diane the other day, I said, I believe that if we put a clock up on the times that we're living in, I do believe we're living in the end times. And I believe that the scripture tells us all these things that's going to happen. And I believe that we're in the beginning of sorrows. And listen to this. He says this is found over in Matthew chapter 24, verse 32. And I won't hold you very much longer, so just hang on with me a minute. Now learn a parable of the fig tree. When its branch is yet tender and putteth forth leaves, you know that summer is nigh. Now he's giving us illustration there and telling us that we see the trees have put forth their leaves. So we understand that summer's right on out in front of us. Give us the illustration to show us. He said, so likewise, ye, when you shall see all these things, know that it is near, even at the doors. So now I'm going to read you some of the things that Jesus said would take place before the end time. But here, before I read you that, he's saying, now realize that when you see all these things happen, that the end is at the door. So keep that in mind. Verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass till all these things be fulfilled. Now, God said, or Jesus said, all these things will be fulfilled. But of that day and hour knoweth no man. Now, all these people that are predicting that it's coming this day and that day and that day, the Bible says that they're false prophets, because no man knoweth the day nor the hour. But I did read to you that he shows to all of us that there will be signs. I read to you here that he said, when you see the fig tree put forth leaves, you know that summer is nigh. So we saw all the leaves on the trees that's been put forth here in the last few weeks. We know that summer's nigh. So he's telling us, no man knows the day nor the hour, but we will know the signs. All right. He said, not even the angels in heaven know, but my Father only. But he said, now listen to this. He said, but as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Now, we look back and say, well, what was the days of Noah like? Well, the scripture tells us exactly what the days of Noah was like. And now, listen to this. The only people that were saved from the flood was Noah and his family. And why were they saved? Because they believed the word of God, and God had told Noah to build an ark, and they believed what God said, and they come and got on the ark. Now, look at this. Noah did not shut the doors to the ark. Noah built them doors, but the Bible says that God shut to the doors of the ark. So man cannot close the doors to this, but God himself will. Now, Noah, they saw the signs. The people all saw the signs of Noah building the ark and Noah preaching the word and telling the people. And they say, why, Noah, you're crazy. I'm sure a lot of people think Madison McCracken is crazy by believing this. But I want to tell you something. Them precious little old grandbabies that looked up to me as I was talking to them yesterday, that has accepted the Lord Jesus Christ, I love them with all of my heart. And I believe, and I've told them about Jesus, and their parents have told them about Jesus, and they've accepted Jesus, and that just blesses my heart. And all of you people here that have accepted Jesus Christ, that blesses my heart. And if there's any out there today that's listening that has not accepted him, please accept him before it's everlasting too late, because the clock's winding down. As the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man. Was in the days of before the flood, they were eating, drinking, marrying, giving in marriage, until the day that Noah entered into the ark, and knew not until the flood came. These people had went to sleep on God. They had forgotten about all that God had done, all the words that God had spoke. They had forgotten about it. They had went to sleep, and the flood come. People, the Bible says, don't go to sleep, and knew not until the flood came and took them all away. So shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Then shall be two in the field, the one shall be taken, the other left. Two women shall be grinding at the mill, the one shall be taken, the other left. And again he says this, watch therefore, for you know not what hour your Lord doeth come. Got one more scripture, and I'm going to close. It's found in Luke chapter 14 and verse 16. We always try to make excuses for what we're doing. But let me tell you this. When I stand before God, excuses will not work. And whenever this world stands before God, excuses won't work. Now, God has given to us an invitation to be saved. God has given us an invitation to walk as a Christian. But I want you to look what the world is saying. Then said he unto him, a certain man made a great supper and bade many. God is inviting all of us to heaven. But how many of us is going to accept? And sent his servants. God has sent his servants out all over this whole world to preach his word and to give the invitation to the whole world. And the whole world is hearing the word of God. But as I read to you a while ago, seemingly a lot of the world has gone to sleep on the things of God. I heard the people are saying, well, I've heard since I was a little boy or a little girl that Jesus was coming. And now I'm 50, 60, 70, 80 years old. He hadn't come yet. Well, let me tell you something. If he don't come for another, ever how many years, death is going to catch us. And we're going to spend eternity somewhere. So think about that. They all with one consent began to make excuses. The first said to them, I bought a piece of ground and I need to go see it. Have me excused. How many of us has made excuses because we hadn't went to church and now we're not able to go? How many of us has made excuses? Well, God, I don't have time to be a Christian. Lord, I just all of these other people have, the way they've lived, it's just made me not want to be a Christian. Well, let me tell you this. Them other people won't stand before God for you. They'll stand before themselves. And I'll stand before God for myself. And let me give you a little surprise. You'll stand before God for yourself. So God has given us an invitation. They went on down and made all kinds of excuses. Another said, I bought 5 yoke of oxen and I need to go prove them. Have me excused. Another said, I married a wife. I can't come. Have me excused. So that servant came and showed his Lord these things. As God looks down and he sees all these things, he sees all of our hearts wrapped up in the things of the world. You say, Madison, I just don't seem to be able to get away from all these things. Well, let me tell you something. If you'll come to God, you say, a Christian's life is miserable. No, I want to tell you something. It's the best life I've ever lived. It's the best, the most peace I've ever found in my life. And to know that whenever this life is over, I've got a place in heaven. And I want to tell you something today. God is offering that to you today. God is saying, come. God is saying for us to watch, open up our eyes. So my prayer today, people, please, while you have an opportunity, accept the offer that God is God, and that is eternal life. And that brings peace. So let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we humbly bow before you today, thanking you, God, for saving us, and thanking you, God, for the church and every person that you put in this church. And God, I pray that you would just take care of all of us and help us. But Lord, today, if there's one out there that's never been saved, I ask you, God, to allow the Holy Spirit to stir that heart, and that they will find themselves on their knees asking you to forgive them of their sins and come into their heart. And Lord, I'll thank you for it. God, I'll praise you, Lord, for everything that you're going to do. So thank you today for allowing us to be able to speak and to lift up your name. And I pray your blessings go out upon this word today. So thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want to say one other thing in closing. If you're there today and you've been saved, please let us know. We've got a Bible we want to give you, and we want to encourage you on the way. So may God bless you. Thank you.